Chapter 6. A Deep Subject. I woke in darkness, on a hard, irregular surface, wet and cold. My head ached and my sinuses throbbed. I had a weight on my chest. I took a deep breath and tried to use my disorientation to beat back the growing sense of panic. I remembered the pain in my neck, followed by the realization that I'd been shot. Panic gave way to fear, and I was on the edge of hyperventilating. I would have cried out, but I didn't know where I was or who might hear me, and my imagination happily painted answers that only increased my terror. Instead, I tried to steady my breathing and began an inventory. I flexed my fingers, which I've always found to be the most reassuring way to start. Proprioception immediately told me where my hands and arms were. I reached up slowly to remove whatever was sitting on me. My fingers encountered something shaggy, and then it jolted and rushed toward my head. An instant later, Reggie rubbed his face against mine, whimpering with what I took to be relief. I knew exactly how he felt.
"Shh, boy, it's okay," I whispered.
My fingers combed through the ringlets of Reggie's fur and held him close as I slowly sat up. Water, or what I hoped was only water, ran down my back. I'd been lying in several centimeters of liquid, and it had soaked through the back of my clothes. Someone had taken my shoes, but left me my socks. My belt was missing, and my pockets were empty. I wondered briefly about my coat, and then remembered Reggie eating through it, and that I'd tossed its remains back at my office. Cradling Reggie in my arms, I got to my feet and began feeling around in the dark. I moved slowly forward, my squishy socks making faint, splashy sounds until my hands touched a wall. I followed it, walking in a steep arc, my feet splashing echoes. The wall felt like stone, or rather many stones with mortar in the grooves. I walked the wall until I'd gone a tight, full circle. I spent the next half hour feeling every bit of every stone as my anxiety expanded to fill the darkness around me, and discovered neither handholds nor ladder rungs, nor any kind of opening at all. I tucked Reggie under one arm and jumped, flailed my free hand high in the emptiness above me, and touched nothing. Someone had put me here, in a damp room with round walls, made of stone and mortar. "Well, well, well," I said to Reggie. He whined in reply, not getting the joke, but picking up on my own fear. I leaned against the wall and brought him close to my face. I still couldn't see him, but I could feel his breath. "I don't suppose you were taking any notes during my abduction, eh?" Reggie again shoved his face against mine. He didn't lick me. Reggie always licks me. The oddity of it was a welcome distraction. I shifted slightly, held him against me with one arm, and brought my other hand up to his face. I tickled the tuft of beard under his chin, and as I did so, I could feel him opening his mouth. Something dropped into my hand. Two somethings. I juggled him a bit, pinning him against my chest with the crook of my elbow, while using both hands to explore what he'd given me. They felt like spongy cylinders, several centimeters in length, much less that in diameter, ragged at one end, probably where Reggie had bitten through. The other end had a curved, chitinous edge to it, flat across its surface, which was the only part that didn't feel fleshy. I brought the thing closer to my nose. I could smell blood. They were fingers. Naturally, I dropped them. They fell into the darkness with a pair of soft plops and vanished as if they'd never been. In a day of one impossible thing after another, this one shook me most of all. While I knew that buffalo dogs could eat anything, I'd never known one to sink its teeth into a living creature before. "Reggie, did you bite off someone's fingers?" He squirmed against me until he achieved a comfortable position to lick my face. I slumped against the wall and let him, while I considered my circumstances. On the negative side, I'd obviously been abducted and imprisoned. I was cold, wet, barely on the right side of panic, and likely I'd be adding hungry and thirsty to my list as well. I didn't want to test the potability of the puddle at my feet, but I knew it might come to that. On the plus side, whoever had done this apparently needed me alive. I clung to that fact. Other than my frightened buffalo dog, it seemed to be all I had. Judging the passage of time while sitting purposeless at the bottom of a dark well involves talents and skills that I don't possess. I passed the hours mentally reviewing the number of clubs I'd performed and trying to determine if there was an underlying pattern to those I'd been thrown out of. I didn't expect to reach any real insights, but it helped to calm me and keep me focused on something other than the fact that I'd been thrown into a dark well. I'd broken it down into three main causes: hecklers, drunk audience members, and crooked club owners. I still hadn't come to any solid conclusions when my solitude was interrupted by a scraping sound, like wood dragged across stone.
"Are you awake, Earth Monster?"
said a voice from on high. "A heckler if ever there was one," I thought to myself.
"Who wants to know?"
I said, attempting a bravado that I didn't feel. But that's how you have to deal with hecklers. Reggie added an inquiring yip of his own.
"I rather hope your beast had drowned. He nearly killed two of my men."
I looked up. In the blackness overhead, I could see a faintly lighter circle of darkness and a twinkle or two that might have been stars, some 6, maybe 7 meters above. The acoustics of the well played with the voice. Despite a slight Spanish accent, I could tell from its flatness it emerged from a device and not a human throat. The speaker could have been foreign or alien, someone who needed a translator appliance, or just wanted to disguise his true voice.
"Are these men the guys in suits who attacked Montgomery and me?" "Our doctor has stitched up their other injuries, but we fear your beast had swallowed the fingers."
"He wouldn't," I said. "Buffalo dogs don't eat meat. There are so many tastier treats in the world."
"So the fingers are down there? Would you mind tossing them up? We still have time to reattach them if we hurry."
"I would if I could, but I've dropped them. Why don't you come down here and we can look for them together?"
"I'm sorry, but I can't do that," he sighed. "We'll just have to arrange for regrowth treatments."
My fear slipped a little, giving way to a growing anger. "That's alien technology. Isn't it a bit hypocritical for members of Green Aggression to take advantage of it when it suits your needs?"
"Not at all. Until our enemies are vanquished, we allow ourselves the full range of their creations, the better for us to know them and what they are capable of. Or did you think that Kudzu 9 was developed without alien assistance?"
"I can't say that I've given it much thought. You'll pardon me, but I'm a bit preoccupied at the moment."
"Such a cool head you have, Mr. Conroy. Aren't you afraid for your life?"
"You're mistaking logic for calm," I said. "If you wanted me dead, you've already had plenty of time to kill me. You clearly have other plans. And seeing as you've left Reggie with me, you appear to want me as kindly disposed to you as possible."
"You're right on the first point, but not on the second. We tried to leave the beast behind, but he climbed on top of you and started snarling and snapping at anyone who came near. That's how Jimmy lost those fingers and Carl had his arm lacerated. Finally, we just threw the net on both of you and dragged you off. It was easier than risking any more injuries."
In all likelihood, they'd done more than just attempt to leave Reggie behind. I didn't for a moment doubt that they'd tried to tranquilize him or even shoot him with something more lethal, and had only been prevented by his nearly impenetrable hide. "Sorry we've been such a bother to you."
"More than you realize. We had planned for the Kudzu to keep you and your company disorganized for days, maybe weeks. When you cleaned it up in a single night, you forced us to change our plans."
I laughed. It made a weird sound from the bottom of a well. "There I go, inconveniencing you again. So how do you know the Kudzu's all gone? Did you have a spy among the agents on the scene today? One of Montgomery's teams?
You are quick, Mr. Conroy, but we're quicker. We're fighting a war, even if you don't see it that way. We intended a kudzu as another warning, but your unwillingness to listen to reason, combined with the surprising adaptability of your creatures, convinced me to move up our timetable accordingly.
So, what happens now?
Now? Now you sit and wait. When your company meets our demands to stop using your animals at the waste sites and pays us the ransom, you'll get to go free, and Green Aggression will have solved its financing problems for years to come.
It wasn't a bad plan. Despite its worth, Buffalogic was a tiny company, and my employees were fiercely loyal. They'd do anything Green Aggression demanded to get me back. Sounds like you've got it all figured out.
What, did you think we were novices? We often improvise, but we are not naive. We're dedicated to our cause. But I wouldn't expect the Earth Monster to understand that.
Earth Monster, right. Say, I don't suppose you could toss down a few towels for the old Earth Monster? It's more than a trifle damp down here.
I'm letting you leave, Mr. Conroy. I'm not inclined to offer you any amenities. But don't worry. I'll stop in now and then to keep you informed and fed. But if you'll excuse me, I need to go leak word of our demands back to your friend Montgomery.
You didn't kidnap him as well?
Better for us to have him running around trying to find you than persecuting us.
What will you do if they don't pay the ransom?
The same thing we'd eventually do even if they did pay. Your buffalo dogs are an abomination on this planet. We won't be content until they are shipped off-world or destroyed. But we're not the insane fringe group you make us out to be. We're not out to ruin your business. Just get it off our planet. If your people are smart and meet our demands, that will be the end of it. Otherwise, we'd be forced to take more drastic actions.
What does that mean?
Nothing complicated. If you or your company insists on being uncooperative, we'll blow up your building and kill your inventory. That should discourage anyone wishing to bring buffalo dogs to Earth.
That's insane. You'd be murdering innocent people.
They had their warning.
What? The kudzu? I asked. The ransom demands?
We only tell you once. If your people are still working there after our little warning, well, they've made their own choice. Think of it as evolution in action. They're obviously too enamored of alien technology to be allowed to live in an Earth-based society.
Before I could work up any kind of reply, he slid the lid over the opening until even that suggestion of light was gone. Damn. I slumped against the wall and petted Reggie. I don't suppose things can get much worse, do you? Reggie licked my face again. Then he farted.